Amendment Bill 2013. Motion. Proposed resolution under the Interpretation and General Clauses Ordinance to amend the Air Pollution Control, Air Pollutant Emission Controlled Vehicles Regulation. Members who wish to speak on the motion will please press the request to speak button. I now call upon the Secretary to speak and move the motion. Secretary. Mr. Deputy. I move that the Air Pollution Control, Air Pollutant Emission Control Vehicles Regulation be amended so as to take an important step forward in improving the roadside air quality by regulating the retirement arrangements of diesel commercial vehicles. First of all, I would like to express my sincere appreciation to the subcommittee for the efforts scrutinizing the regulation and the invaluable views they offered, in particular the leadership of Ms. Sid Ho, the chairman of the subcommittee. In view of the comments of the subcommittee, we've proposed a motion of amendment and have obtained the support of the subcommittee. To improve roadside air quality and better protect public health, the CE proposed in the 2013 policy address to phase out some 80,000 pre-Euro 4 diesel commercial vehicles through an incentive-cum-regulatory approach and to limit the service life of newly registered diesel commercial vehicles at 15 years. The implementation of this proposal can reduce vehicle emissions of RSP and nitrogen oxides by 80% and 30% respectively, contributing to the attainment in 2020 of the new air quality objectives that will take effect soon. Since the WHO classified diesel engine exhaust as carcinogenic mid last year, phasing out these vehicles can reduce the cancer risk associated with exposure to diesel engine exhaust fumes. Besides, setting a service life limit of 15 years for newly registered diesel commercial vehicles enables timely replacement of diesel commercial vehicles in the long run for improving roadside air quality continuously. Having consulted the relevant stakeholders of the transport trades and the electrical panel on environmental affairs, we'll implement this measure through an incentive-cum-regulatory approach in which A, an excretion payment ranging from 27% to 33% of the average taxable values of new vehicles will be offered to eligible vehicle owners for phasing out their pre-Euro 4 diesel commercial vehicles. These vehicles include goods vehicles, non-franchise buses and light buses. The payment level will inversely correlate with the age of the vehicles to be phased out and will remain the same throughout the scheme period. This will give extra impetus for vehicle owners to take action earlier. The excretion payment level will only be linked with the age of the phased-out vehicles and will have no effect on whether vehicle owners procure new vehicles. Pre-Euro 4 diesel commercial vehicles will be phased out in phases with reference to their respective dates of first registration. The retirement deadline for the most polluting pre-Euro diesel commercial vehicles is 1st January 2016, and that for Euro 1 vehicles, 1st January 2017, Euro 2, 1st January 2018, and Euro 3, 1st January 2020. And 3, a service life limit of 15 years will be set for newly registered diesel commercial vehicles. To implement these control measures, I made the regulation under Section 43 of the Air Pollution Control Ordinance, CAP 311. The regulation provides that the retirement deadlines for pre-Euro 4 diesel commercial vehicles with reference to their first registration dates and the service life limit of 15 years for diesel commercial vehicles first registered on or after 1st of February 2014. The controlled vehicles, including goods vehicles, light buses and non-franchise buses, are required to, on license application from the retirement deadlines or from its 15th anniversary date of first registration, as the case may be, comply with the emission standards applicable to them as if they were first registered on the date of the vehicle license application. Failure to comply with the requirement may be a ground for the Commissioner for Transport to refuse to license the vehicles under Section 25.12c of the Road Transport Ordinance. As for the excretia payment, the government will seek funding approval from the FC as soon as possible after the enactment of the regulation for implementing the excretia payment scheme and receiving applications in the first quarter of 2014. After careful deliberation, the committee as a whole supported the regulation but proposed amending Section 6 of the regulation. Section 6 of the regulation is to provide exemption power to the authority, which is the Director of Environmental Protection, to exempt a controlled vehicle or a type of controlled vehicle from the application of the regulation if exceptional circumstances exist that make it impractical or unreasonable for the controlled vehicle or type of controlled vehicles to comply with the regulation. The exemption may be granted subject to any conditions the director thinks fit. For exempting a controlled vehicle, a director must give the registered owner of the concerned vehicle a written notice of the exemption. For exempting a type of controlled vehicle, DEP must publish notice of exemption in the Gazette. The regulation provides that such notice of exemption is not subsidiary legislation. The subcommittee considered that providing the notice of exemption granted by DEP for a type of controlled vehicles under the regulation is not subsidiary legislation may deprive LegCo of its powers to scrutinize the notice. The original intent of empowering DEP to grant exemption is to cater for unforeseeable cases, such as the supply of new vehicles has been disrupted under certain exceptional circumstances, such that vehicle owners cannot replace their old vehicles with new ones as scheduled, leaving them with no choice but to discontinue their operation. Having considered the views of the subcommittee, we consider that the chance that exemption for a type of controlled vehicles is required is slim, and therefore propose amending the regulation by repealing the provisions in the regulation that are relevant to exemption granted by the director in relation to a type of controlled vehicles, while saving the power for the director to exempt individual controlled vehicles. The amendment is set out in a paper delivered to members. Under the revised regulation, the director will consider applications for exemption individually, taking into account the circumstances of each case, and give written notice of exemption to the registered owners of exempted vehicles administratively. The exemption period for each exemption granted will generally be 4 months and will not be more than 1 year. After considering the subcommittee's concerns that the public may wish to know the number of vehicles that have been exempted by the director and the grounds for granting the exemptions, we will, without prejudice to the Personal Data Privacy Ordinance, upload information about such exemptions to the EPD's website and report to the EA panel. The exemption will only be granted for exceptional circumstances after very careful consideration. The subcommittee supported the relevant amendment proposal. I would like to thank the subcommittee again for its efforts and its valuable views. Now, the amendment has the support of the subcommittee. I hope that members will support the amendment so that the regulation that controls highly polluting diesel commercial vehicles can be implemented as soon as possible. I now propose the question to you, and that is that the motion moved by the secretary be passed. Ms. Sitho.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy. As Chairman of the Subcommittee on Air Pollution Control, Air Pollutant Emission Controlled Vehicles Regulation, I now report to this Council the scrutiny work of the Subcommittee. The Subcommittee held 4 meetings to scrutinize the regulation and receive views from deputations. In order to improve roadside air quality, protect public health, and take care of the needs of the industries, members were in general supportive of the legislation. The purpose of the regulation is to phase out about 80,000 pre-Euro 4 diesel commercial vehicles, including lorries, minibuses, and non-franchised buses, and set retirement deadlines. The subcommittee is of the view that there is concern that in comparison with this original proposal in May 2013, the retirement deadlines for Euro 1, Euro 2 and Euro 3 diesel commercial vehicles in the present proposal of the administration are each deferred by 1 year. While such deferment can lessen the financial and operational hardships of existing vehicle owners, the public will be exposed to air pollutants emitted from these old diesel commercial vehicles for longer. The subcommittee examined whether the deadlines in its original proposal can be retained. The administration advised that the revised retirement deadlines for Euro 1, 2 and 3 diesel vehicles will provide more time for the vehicle scrapping trade and the vehicle bodybuilding trade to tackle the surge of demand resulting from the phasing out program and allay the doubts and worries of the transport trades, but will not compromise the attainment of the new air quality objectives by 2020 and the compliance with the 2015 and 2020 emission reduction targets set by the government. The administration stressed that for the most polluting pre-Euro diesel vehicles, the retirement deadline will remain unchanged, that is the 1st of January 2016. The subcommittee noted that the retirement deadlines for pre-Euro, Euro 1, Euro 2 and Euro 3 diesel vehicles being the 1st of January of 2016, 2017, 2018 and 2020 respectively might cause unwary vehicle owners to misunderstand that their vehicles can still run on the road for the entire year of 2016, 2017, 2018 and 2020 respectively. On this, the administration undertook that when publicising the regulation in future, it will emphasise that pre-Euro 4 diesel commercial vehicles had to be phased out no later than the 31st of December of the year immediately preceding the retirement deadline, in order to avoid the misunderstanding that these highly polluting vehicles would still be licensed after that day. So, Mr. Deputy, sometimes at public hearings, if we pay attention to the views of the trades, it's very beneficial to us. During the scrutiny, the subcommittee discussed the impact of the regulation on the transport trades and vehicle owners. For instance, whether the program will lead to rapid rising of vehicle prices, the ability of the trades to cope with the upsurge of car replacement, and whether the government is providing sufficient support to affected car owners. To observe the mandatory retirement deadline for diesel vehicles, the transport trades face many difficulties. In particular, they'll incur substantial cost in buying vehicles to replace the phased-out vehicles. We noted that many SMEs in the transport trades could not afford the expenses and had to close their business. The subcommittee examined ways and means to assist the trades to replace vehicles. The government pointed out that the views of the trades had been taken on board, such that ex-gratia payment at 27% to 33% of the average taxable value of new vehicles will be payable to owners of pre-Euro 4 diesel commercial vehicles as long as they're scrapped before the specified retirement deadlines, regardless of whether the owners would acquire replacement vehicles. The government further advised that SMEs may replacing their vehicles might consider applying for loans under the SME Loan Guarantee Scheme. The subcommittee was concerned that Section 6.1 of the regulation provides that the authority, that is the Director of Environmental Protection, may in exceptional circumstances exempt a controlled vehicle or a type of controlled vehicles from the regulation and that the gazetted notice on the exemption is not subsidiary legislation and so is not subject to negative vetting by LegCo. As this exemption may affect the public, the subcommittee opined that the LegCo should have the power to scrutinise the gazetted exemption decision and so require the administration to make appropriate amendments. In response, the government proposed to amend Section 6 of the regulation to remove the provision that empowers the government to exempt a type of controlled vehicles. The government can exempt individual vehicles only via administrative arrangements. In future, when extreme circumstances are exceptional. Individual car owners can apply to the administration for exemption, and the exemption period shall not exceed 1 year. So the subcommittee will not move any amendment. Now let me turn to my own opinion. In relation to the proposed amendment to Section 6, I'd like to say that when the government amends legislations, it always retains powers and rooms for itself to exercise discretion. We're very worried about these discretions. In particular, in the drafting of the amendments and discretion, the government has always been adopting a broad-brush approach, saying that the legislation are impracticable and cannot be enforced. And usually, a series of factors are formulated for the exercise of discretion to regulate the government. But here, in this regulation, there's none. Well, the government will say that there's a precedent. It's just like switching off the engines of idling vehicles. But that is different. If you switch off the air conditioner of a vehicle, if certain electronic devices are to be affected, the vehicles concerned will be exempted. But for such emissions, why a certain vehicle or type of vehicle should be exempted? The government failed to give an answer. Rather, members thought of an example. Say if there is a tsunami, the whole production line failed, no delivery can be effected, and because of special circumstances, no replacement can be effected, so an exemption can be applied for. By and large, subcommittee members accepted that there can be exemptions. However, we requested the government to put the requirements clearly. But the government said, oh, don't scrutinize me. This is not subsidiary legislation. You're not empowered to scrutinize me. But for the gazetted notice, if it does not spell out whether they are administrative notices or statutory notices, so will it happen that once again, the legislature will ask the administration to give us back the power of scrutiny of subsidiary legislation. So there was a controversy. The government came back with some funny replies. It said that the director would not have the power. The bureau director will have to instruct the director to exercise the discretion. Well, that's even more unreasonable. We now have the accountability system. It's very clear that the powers of the bureau and the department should be segregated. In particular, for the politically appointed officials, they're accountable for their policies. They formulate policies and promote them. But for the day-to-day operation of the heads of departments, they can exercise discretion in the exercise of powers. If the Department of Justice now tells us that the power of discretion has to come from the Bureau, it will be disregarding the discussions on the accountability system. It has also neglected one point, that is, civil servants should be politically neutral, and the Bureau should have the power to formulate policies. The two are segregated, and there is a check and balance between the two in terms of political accountability. We welcome that the administration had heeded our advice. After expeditious discussion, we reached a consensus. We accept that you have the discretion. Then you'd better write that discretion clearly. That is, to what extent? Now it's clear. An extension of a year. At the same time, not for a type of vehicles, but to do it vehicle by vehicle. So this is discretion on individual circumstances. If something is to happen for discretion for one type of vehicles, then there's no way out. You have to go through the vehicles one by one. So for Section 6, in relation to the power of the legislature to scrutinize laws, there are now more details in the amendments. As for the whole regulation and its content, we of course support it. We see that in recent times on the mainland, there are a lot of issues. Everybody is breathing in the same air with harmful substances. Well, Hong Kong hasn't reached that state yet, so we should do more. The amendment of the regulation gives us this incentive come regulation approach. The government promises to give $10 billion for the replacement of diesel vehicles. So when the Bureau discussed with the industries, it would be more convenient. At the beginning, the Bureau was of the view that the older the vehicle, the more the extra payment, because the highly polluting vehicle should be eliminated from our roads as soon as possible. But the trades think differently. For the new vehicles, if they are subject to such constraints, they are to be eliminated. They haven't reached the end of their lifespan yet. So the loss on the part of the transport trades is higher. So for the newer vehicles like Euro 1, 2 or 3 vehicles, they can get a higher extra payment. I think this time we can commend the Bureau. Yes, it has a huge sum of money in hand. It's easier for them to work. Before they introduced the legislation to the LegCo, they tried their very best to discuss with the trades and political parties, listen to their concerns, and where and when practicable, reach consensus after listening to views. Of course, it's again a question of money. $10 billion has been increased to $11.7 billion, such that the owners of Euro 3 vehicles are more satisfied. Another compromise is you don't need to replace your vehicle. You can do retirement. That is, if the vehicle owner gets the extra payment but cannot afford a new vehicle, he can opt for early retirement. For these car owners who opt for early retirement of their vehicles, they are also entitled to an extra payment. That's reasonable. The Bureau listened to that piece of opinion. This time, among the industries, the government and political parties, there were discussions to reduce arguments, such that such a piece of controversial legislation can be scrutinized completely in 4 meetings. I hope that parties concerned can model on this example. Please discuss early. Don't try to canvass votes at the last minute. Political parties would like to support you, but they're not satisfied. There's a loophole, which the Bureau also admits. The regulation specifies that new vehicles registered after the 1st of February 2014, there should be a retirement lifespan of 15 years, but the replacement can be for Euro 3 vehicles only. That means Euro 4 or Euro 5 vehicles registered before the 1st of February 2014 will not be subject to this 15 years of retirement requirement. Is it that Euro 4, Euro 5 vehicles registered before the 1st of February 2014 can last endlessly? Well, the Bureau was put in a dilemma. Given this retirement age of 15 years, theoretically, all vehicles should be subject to the same restriction. So the Bureau could only say that by 15 years, they would assess your emission standard. Is it up to the prevailing standard? If it is up to standard, you can continue. Altogether, we have 46,600 such vehicles. In the communication between officials and us, we understood that sooner or later they have to handle these vehicles. But if they are to eliminate all the 130,000 diesel commercial vehicles in one go, particularly when some of them are very new, this political bomb is very difficult to dismantle. So now we have a solution acceptable to all. But I would like to remind you that these vehicles have to be handled in time. Otherwise, they'll be emitting exhaust gas on our roads. Thank you.
Mr. Frankie Yek. President, concerning phasing out older Euro diesel vehicles, well, the Environment Bureau's consulted the trades last year, and the FS and the CE announced in the budget and in the policy address announced that a sum of $10 billion will be reserved for the phasing out retirement of old Euro diesel vehicles. But then the trades expected something very different. I have had many meetings with the trades to try to improve on the government proposed arrangements, and I reflected their views timely to the administration. I believe other parties and members of this council make the similar efforts, and now we have an implementation plan, and more than a year has passed since the idea was proposed. Although we spent quite a lot of time on this, but we have managed to forge a consensus in spite of the preliminary gap between them. So I hope, and I'd echo Ms. Sitho's views that other bureaus should learn from the Environment Bureau in that they should understand the situation of the trades before they propose any changes. The former Secretary for the Environment said environmental protection comes at a price. I agree, but the price should not be paid just by the transport trades. And the transport trades are there to support the various economic activities, our daily necessities, foodstuff items, and other things that we need to have to be distributed and transported to various locations by the transport trades. With the development of the economy, the transport trades are also developing. And now, because of air pollution, people blame the transport trades. This is not fair. Vehicle owners and drivers are just ordinary citizens. They understand that emissions carry a health risk. Therefore, the trades are basically in support of phasing out of old diesel vehicles, because new vehicles are more economical on fuel consumption, and their operations can only be enhanced. But they don't think that their livelihood should be ignored. To strike a balance, the trades have made some reasonable improvement measures to the proposals, so that we can work together to reduce emission on the road. Some 80,000 vehicles will be involved for the phasing out exercise of Euro 3 or earlier vehicles. According to the Transport Department, only 5,000 or so will be scrapped per year. So it would take more than 15 years for a natural phasing out to take place. If we want to phase out the 80,000 vehicles earlier, because of the demand and supply, there will be a shortage of supply or ancillary equipment, and prices may go up. Now, under the revised proposal, the retirement time will be delayed by 1 year, and the expenditure payment will be delinked from the purchase of new vehicles, so that owners have more time to make arrangements and there's more flexibility for owners. They don't have to rush to buy vehicles and relevant devices in a rush, pushing up the prices. And now it seems that the trades have to pay the majority of the bulk of the price, and the government only pay a small part. Many single vehicle owners do not have the means to purchase new vehicles. If they phase out their vehicles, they don't have the money to top up the payment required for new vehicles, and for many, it's too early to retire. So instead of 10% to 30% of the taxable value of vehicles, it's now 27% to 33% of the taxable values concerned. So these single vehicle owners have their pressure lessened, and of course it's a bigger incentive for them to purchase new vehicles upon receipt of the expenditure allowance. and the cost would increase from $8.7 billion to $11.7 billion. It's an increase of $3 billion. According to Dr. Lahat Kang, who came to this council to brief the subcommittee on air pollution and light pollution, that in 2012, air pollution caused 3,069 deaths, 150,000 emissions, and a cost of $40 billion. So by spending $3 billion more, we can avoid the economic cost of air pollution to the tune of $40 billion. This is just a very worthy course of action. As for the stipulated 15 years of service life limit, according to the trades, some vehicles are well maintained. 15 years would be too short. That would add to the cost, operating costs of SMEs. There are also operators of nanny buses and also the transport companies of fruit and fresh produce. They say the mileage of their vehicles is low. That it's not economical or environmentally friendly for their vehicles to be phased out in 15 years. So with the advance of technology, we cannot rule out that in 15 years of time, these vehicles can be retrofitted with certain devices, and they would be able to meet the prevailing emission standards of the time. Since this cannot be ruled out, the administration should allow their licenses to be renewed. So the administration, at the end of the day, just accepted this. If after 15 years, the vehicles could comply with the latest emission standards of the time, their licenses can be renewed. And after the announcement of the phasing out of vehicles older than Euro 3, many companies have postponed their replacement programs, especially non-franchised buses. At present, there's a so-called COF, a Certificate of Fitness examination involving removal of the body frame of the vehicle. And now they're postponed. Now the timetable has been postponed, and the replacement program has to be postponed as well. Their livelihood may be affected because some of the parts will no longer be available. The trades are concerned that if new diesel vehicles will have to be retired in 15 years, and then the COF will be required on reaching the 13th year, that would be too costly for them. Fortunately, the administration has streamlined and improved the COF examination so as to avoid the excessive cost. During the scrutiny of the regulation, members expressed concern about the criteria for granting exemptions. We understand that the discretion might be necessary because in some circumstances, the vehicle owners may not be able to replace his vehicle in time, within 15 years. And the vehicle owner may have to use the vehicle which is supposedly retired. But the criteria for exercising the discretion should be made public, and also the validity of the discretion exemption should be made clear. I support the regulation and the relevant amendments.
Mr. Kenneth Chan, the Civic Party is of the view that we should try to resolve the problem of roadside air pollution. We are concerned about pollutants emitted by diesel vehicles and the impact of such pollutants on air quality and on the health of the people. Many are of the view that environmental protection and people's livelihood are mutually exclusive. But then good air quality will benefit employees. Now, when I was a child, my mother was a mini school bus driver. It was a diesel vehicle, and I, in fact, when I was a child, suffered from asthma. So I want to say that concerning the drivers of diesel vehicles and their family members, they or their health is affected by these old diesel vehicles. So I just want to say that people's livelihood and environmental protection are complementary. They are not mutually exclusive. But in Hong Kong, many people are a bit short-sighted and they may have lost sight of long-term health considerations. Just now, some members talked about public health and medical costs. In fact, the Civic Party has been of the view that concerning air quality, the medical costs, these issues must be taken together. And I think it's good that the government has come to realize that these factors should be taken as a whole. Now, previously, only incentives were offered and there was no statutory requirement to replace the vehicles. There was no statutory retirement period. Now, previously, incentives were provided and then they were enhanced amounts offered, but then they were not attractive enough to many vehicle owners. And the Civic Party supports this present proposal. This present proposal has the support of the Civic Party. Now, so we understand that air quality, people's livelihood, medical costs, the health of other road users, I think it's clear that these are all interrelated. In 2013 October, the WHO had an international cancer center, IARC, and in fact, a link or a relationship was established between air pollution and cancer. And so, in fact, the announcement was made by WHO in October. And then in June 2010, the IARC announced that emissions from diesel engines were classified as grade 1 or class 1 carcinogenic substances. Yes, we understand that the transport sector has its concerns. Now, we are not saying that we want to improve roadside air quality and protect the health of the public at the expense of the transport sector. It's just not a zero-sum game. In fact, colleagues from Hong Kong UCU and UST have been reminding us of the relationship among the various factors. The Civic Party supports the idea of using money to buy health, so to speak. We do have the resources to encourage those in the transport sector to, as soon as possible, replace their old diesel vehicles. But then, can we use more money to try to bring about more and earlier improvement to our air quality? In fact, in the subcommittee, Mr. Wong told us his blueprint for air quality improvement. He has laid down certain air quality objectives for 2020. But I believe Mr. Wong should be more courageous and more resolute. And we hope that we can have an even better timetable for achieving the air quality objectives. We want to see the early attainment of the objectives. Yes, I understand that an extra $1 billion dollars will have to be incurred. You will come to FC for funding. But then the retirement timetable will be put back for 1 year, despite the fact that extra expenditures to be incurred. So, yes, some may say that the administration is flexible, it has come round to good advice. And you may say that there are constraints like the time taken for the procurement of vehicles. Yes, I understand that the administration may give us a lot of reasons. So we will try to appreciate and understand these reasons. But the fact is that more money will have to be spent, but the timetable will be put back. Euro 1 vehicle from 1st January 2016 to 1st January 2017. Euro 2 from 1st January 2017 to 1st January 2018. Then Euro 3 from 1st January 2019 to 1st January 2020. Only the timetable for pre-Euro diesel commercial vehicles has remained unchanged. Now, Mr. Wong may tell us that we need not worry. We'll still be able to beat the deadlines in the AQO blueprint. But then, according to the Headley Index of the Hong Kong U, in the first 6 months of 2013, the air pollution in Hong Kong caused a lot of consequences. 1,606 premature deaths, 76,000 more hospital days, and financial losses amounting to hundreds of millions of dollars. So I hope that the administration will not just take into account environmental protection or just the interests of the transport sector. You have to take into account the entire Hong Kong public interest. Now, extra expenditure will be needed, and yet we are putting back the timetable by 1 year. We're talking about lives. We're talking about financial losses, medical bills, hospital days. So, yes, we will support the administration on this occasion, and we will also support the administration's proposal with regard to exemptions. But then with regard to the putting back of the retirement deadline for 1 year, I think the price to be paid has to be made very clear. So we shouldn't just applaud today's decision. We shouldn't regard this as a model for other departments to follow. Yes, extra money will have to be spent, but I think health is a more important consideration, and we don't want the deadline to be put back. But we understand that because of negotiations and bargaining, the timetable has to be put back. And the civic party is extremely disappointed because we're talking about lives and also people's health. Thank you. Does any other member wish to speak? If not, I call upon the Secretary for the Environment to reply. The Secretary, please. Yes, President. I thank members and the transport sector for their understanding. I think this is a pragmatic motion. We have in mind public health and also the need to improve roadside air quality. And this is all I want to say. Thank you. Thank you, President. And I'll put a question to you, and that is that the motion moved by the Secretary be passed. Will those in favour please raise their hands? Those against? I think the question is agreed by a majority of the members present. I declare the motion passed.